Now is the time to be brave. More than ever, do we need to stand together as brothers. Surely, like all brothers, we have fought one another from time to time. But in times of great danger, we have always joined together. As is the case of the past, we can look to the Huns when they came swarming in over Europe. Or when the Ottomans were outside the gates of Vienna, Europe pulled together and repelled the enemy. However, today we are faced with the most insidious danger of our entire history. We're facing an enemy we have never before faced at this magnitude, and it's not Islam, however real that danger may be. We have beaten back Islam before, and we will do it again. The problem of Islam and mass immigration into Europe is just a symptom of a deeper sickness that is plaguing our societies. The real problem is subversion of our governments on a massive scale with a hostile ideology. It is a mind virus of mechanical modernity has infected our academia, media, and politicians, both to the left and to the right. A pilfered rottenness is infecting the whole political spectrum. We have to stop thinking in terms of left and right, thinking that either one holds an answer. The real spiritual fight stands between what is organic and authentic on the one side and what is mechanical and synthetic on the other side. We must realize that the nation is one organic whole. It is like a body or a meta-organism, and it depends on all its parts working properly and harmoniously. A house divided among itself will fall. Modernism is predicated on the quasi-religious belief in equality and progress. Progress here is thought of as a mechanical process. It falsely conflates technological advancement with moral progression. The dogmatic and unrealistic belief in equality prompts the established media, together with our politicians, to push for multiculturalism. They justify this by claiming that everyone is fundamentally equal and atomized individuals. This means that anyone or anything can be reduced to interchangeable cogs in a mechanical machinery of modernity, independent of cultural background or ethnical background. Equality in the modern sense goes against every law of nature, disregarding differentiation and the real diversity. The acknowledgement of heritage and tradition as an intrinsic value is denied by modernism. The value of heredity is attempted, deconstructed, and reduced to something marginal and trivial. People don't know where they're coming from, who they are, or where they're going. This is the reason we have ended up in the situation we have. Transgenderism with abortions, that's why we're ending up with mass immigration, and that's why we're ending up with the cultural and ethnic suicide of our societies. The socialists, these self-proclaimed champions and guardians of the working class and the downtrodden and the poor, no longer serve its own people. They have left the working man for a cesspool of identity politics and fancy-looking globalism. It is clear to anyone with sight to see that socialism and the labor movement have played out and lost their historical mission. The working class would be better off electing a nationalist government truly working for the best interest of its own people. But the case is even worse when it comes to the so-called conservatives. They have failed at their post over and over and over again. These are the real people we have to get rid of, these fake conservatives. Not only have they failed, but they are peddling false hope like a snake oil salesman to a dying man. This failure of the so-called conservatives stems from lacking the guts and the moral fiber to stand up for what is right and true in fear of something as benign as social ridicule. Or in some cases, they are even deliberately consorting with agents of globalism that is actively working to undermine our national sovereignty. However, there are none more deserving of our ire and wrath as the petty bourgeoisie, these craven and weak, yet ambitious for status and position, have shied away from their responsibility to their nation and people once confronted with an uncomfortable opposition. Always choosing the easy and comfortable path, often lining their pockets along the way. No other class has pushed so much for the atomization of society than the bourgeoisie, uprooting our traditions just to turn another profit margin. And thus, knowingly or unwittingly, they have aligned themselves with the subversive force of modernity. All this in the name of liberty, when they have not the foggiest idea what freedom means, nor the cost of it or the duties that comes along with the concept of freedom. Freedom is not free. It comes with duties and responsibilities. This fall from grace is the fruit of years of indoctrination. Much of this indoctrination origins from such schools as the Frankfurter School with critical Marxist theory, hell-bent to deconstruct anything of a sacred character. This intellectual poison has infested almost every social science department of every university in the West, holding as its highest achievement the deconstruction of beauty, truth, and justice. But it goes deeper than that. Modernity has its origins in what is ironically called the Enlightenment, culminating with the horrors of the French Revolution. And today, the process of modernism is almost complete, turning on itself, cannibalizing everything in its path, leaving us wide open to be picked clean by an international, bureaucratic, and financial elites of cronies. The mechanisms of control are insidious. It turns family member against family member. It turns children against their parents. It turns woman against man, employee against employer. It pits brother against brother. It turns mothers against their wombs through abortion. It even turns the church against Christ. In Sweden, they are now calling Jesus the Christ by a third gender pronoun, hen, when referring to him in mass. And heroism has been replaced by a victim culture. My friends, things look dire, and indeed they are. But do not despair. There is hope. The hope lives in us, in the very people gathering around Europe, in places much like this. Hope and life lives in our hearts. Even if our societies and civilization should crumble and fall, the flame will live in each one of us as long as we stay true to who we are and where we come from. Like a phoenix, we shall rise again, born anew out of the ashes of yesterday. You have to stop acting on the premises of the very people who wants to dismantle our history, our traditions. We have to tell them loud and clear, we are not buying it. We will expose and dismantle the dismantlers. This is no longer politics for trinkets and baubles. This is an existential fight for our future. This is a fight for the continuation of our heritage and for the survival of our people and nation. And only Europe alone can find this strength within itself to prevail. No one else will come to our aid. No one. We must nurture that strength and that conviction within our hearts. Any remaining doubts or weaknesses we might harbor due to the pestilence of modernity, we must throw to the flames of perdition, and only clarity of mind and purpose must remain to us. Our adversary is a powerful hydra with many heads, manifesting in the forms of NGOs, think tanks, academia, media, corporations, film industry, and supranational constructs such as the EU. If our opponents were able to create such synthetic atrocities as the EU, so should we be able to re-establish the natural order. We have to be honest about our potential. We have to be honest about what is our destiny, and we have to own it. We have the Faustian spirit. The spirit of our people is one of contrast. It is one both of rootedness of soil and at the same time one of exploration and expansion. However far we may wander, this is our homeland. There is no denying it. Europa will forever be our eternal homeland. We are shaped by it. Standing together As free and sovereign nations, we Europeans will be unstoppable. Refusing to be drawn into conflicts among ourselves, we have to stop the infighting and bickery. We have no time for it. We must be the united front that the masses can seek shelter under in the coming storm. We need to create a synergy between different decentralized groups throughout Europe, both within our nations as well joining up with groups in other nations. Victory for one of us is a victory for all of us. The victory in one nation weakens the overall globalist architecture, making it easier for other countries to withdraw and assert its own sovereignty. The beauty of a decentralized system is that it bands together in times of need, while each part remains independent and sovereign. Our generation is the last hope. If we should fail, the light has gone out. There's no rekindling it. And thus we shoulder a great responsibility. For if Europe should fall, so should the light and hope for the whole world fade as well. I do not seek to establish a paradise on earth. Such hubris does not become man. But I do seek to reassert the natural order of tradition, bringing vitality and balance to our people. Our destiny has always been and always will be one of strife, exploration, and expansion. Strive for the improvement of being, to stretch towards the ever-expanding goal of perfection. That is our ideal. Fearless exploration of the unknown, both in inner and outer realms. The search for new continents, the search for new worlds. Explorations in the field of knowledge, bringing us to the honor and the wisdom of past generation. Our destiny lies among the stars. One day our descendants will explore and expand to other worlds. However, that expansion needs a point of rootedness to expand from, and that is Europe, our home. But this destiny can be broken if we let it, so we have to fight for it. The fight will be long and hard, but it is a fight we have to win, and it is a fight we will win if we awake the heroic spirit in our hearts and prove ourselves worthy of the greatness that is our birthright.